We gotta get a clock fixed to the side for you. That clock messed with me all morning.
He's feeling.
I don't have a watch on. I have no idea what time it is.
Oh, no.
I was like, well, if I grow over, I guess I'll leave.
Well, I don't like you. Sharon. Sometimes I wouldn't even say that.
Just do like this.
I guess we should leave it like that more often. I actually got done earlier than usual.
You were so afraid.
I was in panic mode. I was in panic mode. I don't know, is that a battery clock or a electric clock?
I meant to get that, I'll get the one on that today.
I don't know what kind of battery it is.
Double A battery.
Double A?
Is it too tight?
Back in the hearing.
You wanna use my phone?
I've got my phone up here now.
Oh.
I didn't have my phone at the pool then.
Oh, okay.
So I had that. But Sawyer is gonna change the sign for me today. So I'll come in and change the battery while he's doing that. Somebody's gonna change it right now. Y'all are scared to death about me in that car.
We don't want you coming out of the line.
But what's funny though is it's running.
Yeah.
That's what's crazy.
It might be kind of like.
I wish we had a clock out in the lobby too.
I asked somebody one time, said, what time you got over at Hoss? He said, the same time you do over there.
That's great. Well, this is why we're live, and that'll help us with our time, too. Great to see everybody. Glad that everybody is able to be online with us. I know we have several folks that are gone because it's spring break here in 11, the county. I don't know if it's 11 city and the county together on this. The county, I know the county is because our kids are out for the next coming week. So. And I know we have some people that are gone somewhere for the weekend, but they're actually tuned in with us this morning. That's pretty cool, too.
You guys are awesome. You've got to change that,
just don't fall. Hey,
now watch him quit moving while you're up there. You'll think he was.
Yeah, just keep on going.
That's what we got to do about
24 minutes.
Oh, that's right.
I'm going to go ahead and just set it for.
Hey, I tell you what, I'm going to go ahead and just set it for. You know it's an hour ahead.
Yeah. I thought you were going
to. Yeah, just go ahead and set it for.
What's time to go out here? Come here.
Now we're down this morning.
It's one of the main clock in Active Friends.
Is it?
Yeah. Not really.
Well, as I say, even a broken clock is still accurate or twice.
I just said he didn't want you all over.
Well, now we're running ahead of time. Great to see everybody in this beautiful Lord's Day morning. Absolutely gorgeous. Second Kings chapter 5. We have part two of our lesson that started from last week on a skewed sense of reality. I want us to review a little bit of last week's lesson. Last week's lesson is the account very familiar to us. I remember flannel graphs of this lesson when I was a little kid growing up. Did y'all have flannel graphs when you were little? I remember flannel graphs of this lesson. It dealt with the healing of Naaman, who was one of the commanders of the forces of Aram. And he had what disease?
Leprosy.
And, you know, a lot of times, especially something that we really don't have to deal with in our country today, a lot of times we can kind of gloss over leprosy. But we really should, because it's still prevalent in parts of the world today. There are leper colonies in third world countries today. And I showed you pictures of people that had leprosy last week. It's a disease that affects the nerve endings. When the nerve endings die, then the tissues around those nerve endings deteriorate. And it quickly affects the extremities of the body, the fingers, the toes, the ears, the nose, to where they literally die and fall off. So you can see how gnarled this lady's toes are, just so difficult to even look at. Could you even imagine what it was painful to walk on or to try to survive with? And this is someone's hand that they have leprosy. And you can see what happens to their fingers. And so in biblical times, I equate it to a lot to how we hear about and deal with cancer today. Leprosy was the cancer of the day back then that people had. And when you got a diagnosis of leprosy, it was a death sentence. And how did it affect your life? Not just medically, but socially. You had to be separated from everybody. So you had to leave your family, leave your friends, leave your community, and live out in the wilderness. And if anybody was walking around you and came up on you, they had to call out what? I'm unclean, I have leprosy. I am a leper. So that people would not get too close. So you can imagine how devastating the news would be that someone had leprosy. In last week's lesson, we saw how that the country of Aram had taken some Israelites prisoner. And one of them was a young lady who became the maid of Naaman's wife. And what was her feelings about the commander getting sick with leprosy? Even though she was basically a prisoner of war, he was such a good man that what? She was distressed, wanted him to be made whole, made to be well. And she said, it's too bad what? It's too bad that he can't meet the prophet in Israel, because the prophet of Israel could heal him of his leprosy. So Naaman heard about that. He went to his boss, who was the king, and he said, hey, do you have a problem with me going down to Israel, to this prophet of the people of Israel, to see if I can be cured of my leprosy? And the king said, go at once, and I'm going to give you some letters. What else did he take with him? Clothing? Gold? Silver? And so he makes this journey. So we talked about a few points from last week. Never underestimate God's power, purpose, and plan for your life. We looked at it from the standpoint of this Israelite maid. If you were basically a slave against your will, as a prisoner of war, would it be difficult to have a favorable mindset of your captors? Could you become bitter? Could you become angry? And if you were like that, what would have happened when Naaman got sick with leprosy? What would have been your mindset?
Good.
Yeah, baby. Yeah. Get him. Sick him. Right? That wasn't it at all. He was such a good man that she was sad that he was sick and wanted him to be made whole. I just want to reiterate again today how powerful we live our lives is a testimony to who we live our lives with. Not to be bitter, crabby, mean-spirited people, but she did that. And it has made a difference throughout all the ages of time, even today. Doesn't this make an impact on our lives today, our faith? Yes. Naaman was a good man, and he was someone that his boss thought so well of. He wanted to do whatever it took to get him well, at whatever cost it took to get him well. And he made sure that all the kings and all the dignitaries of the area knew that he had permission to be there, and he wanted them to get help. And so, as we read last week, he arrived at the king's house in Israel, and the king of Israel got mad. Why are you coming to me? Am I God that I can do anything about leprosy? And when Elisha heard that, he got upset. He said, why have you torn your clothes? Why are you upset? Because basically, it was something that God was going to do a mighty work in, as God was going to cure Naaman of his leprosy. So, we're going to pick up our reading today in 2 Kings 5. Beginning with verse 8, we're going to look at the fact that Naaman, even though he was a good man, he wasn't thinking straight. Do you all know of any good people today that don't exactly think straight? Well, basically, we all could be in that boat, couldn't we? Have you ever not thought straight sometimes? Has your attitude been a little wacko before? No. Of course it has. Y'all are good folks, but you have your moments, right? All right. Verse 8. 2 Kings 5. When Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent him this message. Why have you torn your robes? Have a man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel. Elisha is saying to the king, hey, this is a time for God to shine in the lives of another nation. So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him, go wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed. And we saw last week how he got mad about that. Why was Naaman mad? He's a commander of the forces of Aram. He's a dignitary, if you will, a powerful person. And this is Elisha, a prophet in a country that are basically subservient to them. And Elisha didn't do what? He didn't come out and address him personally. He sent a messenger. This commander was like, what? You're going to send a messenger? I thought you would come out, raise your hand, and pray to your Lord, your God, and place your hand over the spot, and I'd be made well. That's what I thought was going to happen. And now you're telling me that I need to go dip in the Jordan River, immerse myself, dunk myself, how many times?
Seven
times. And that's going to cure leprosy. And his intellectual capacities took over his emotions, and he said what, basically? That's stupid. Dipping in water is not going to cure leprosy. Basically is what he's thinking. And if that is the cure, then what? We got Abner and Farpar back home that are much nicer rivers than what y'all got down here. Could I not just wash in them and be clean if that's all it takes? And the Bible says he turned and went away in a rage. Let me just say this. Be glad. Be thankful for godly people that God puts in your life. He was such a good man that in spite of his pride and ego, there were some people that would not let him go because they knew what one fact. If he turned in a rage and went away, then what? He's going to die alone. And we're not going to let that happen to him. So they went to him and they said, Sir, if he had asked you to do some great thing, wouldn't you have done it? If he asked you to accomplish some great task, great courage or skill, wouldn't you have been glad to do it? All he asked you to do was go dunk in the river 7 times. That's no biggie. If that'll cure your leprosy, Why not? Now, let's get back to Naaman for a minute. There are some people that have so much pride and so much ego that they will never admit they're wrong, even if it kills them. He was a good man, and he realized that what they said, even though they were subservient to him, his servants, they spoke truth. They spoke wisdom, and he realized, you knucklehead, what have I got to lose? And they turned around and they came back and they pulled up to the Jordan. And he gets out. And he gets down into the Jordan River. And he goes under once. He comes up, and what about his condition? Still 11. Twice? Still 11. Three times? Still 11. Four, five, six times, and what? Still 11. But when he went down seven times and he came back up, he was made whole, like new skin. Now, our lesson is a skewed sense of reality. What was skewed about his sense of reality? What messed him up? What almost cost him his life?
Pride.
What about his thought processes? Can we think we're so smart that something so simple could not be possibly true? Yeah. Sometimes, as my grandma used to say, you're getting a little too big for your britches. Sometimes we can think we're so smart, we're so intellectually superior, that anything else is nonsense. And I want to tell you something. We live in a society with a skewed reality that says the scriptures, the word of God, faith in Jesus, belief in God is archaic, antiquish, and it's not valid anymore. And anybody believes all that just believes a bunch of old wives' tales. It's ridiculous. And some people will even get to be where they're intimidating about it. They'll just put you on the spot. You don't believe that stuff, do you? Or, how can you believe in that? That is stupid. I'll never forget my high school biology teacher, the first person I ever met was an atheist. And he tried his best to make all of us feel stupid that believe in God. And I'm telling you something. The crazy stuff going on right now, Dr. Seuss, are you serious? Dr. Seuss? I mean, we're going to start burning books again? Dr. Seuss? Really?
Mr. Potato Head
or Mrs. Potato Head? Really? Are you serious? We've got these people that think they're so smart that they're going to change everything. That everything before us has been wrong and we're going to set the record straight. And what they think is right and what they think is straight is so skewed. It's ridiculous. And I want to just say this. We need to instill this in our kids. The Word of God is not stupid. The Word of God is not old in the sense of where just casting aside. It is perpetual in value. And if the world stands another 2,000 years, the Bible will still be the Word of God. And it still will be the power of God unto salvation. Everyone that believes. And we need to instill in our kids because they are being bombarded by the media that constantly is ridiculing Christianity, that is constantly ridiculing what is faith and goodness and wholesomeness. And so that everybody just do whatever you want to do. As I told you the other day, I was at a business and sitting there on a little plaque on this person's desk was this phrase that said, find your own truth. That message. Yeah, truth is relative. Just find your particular truth that you like, that you want to embrace, and you go with it. When absolute truth is found in God's Word, and anything that disagrees with it, goes against it, is false. It's a lie. It's a deception. And we're gonna have to get that word out and stand by that. And let people allow the word of God to be the standard by which we live by. All right? Hey, Ray, can you bump that woman? Never underestimate the destructive nature of pride. The king of Israel, could he have done a lot of damage if Elisha hadn't been around? Well, he could have caused a war between Israel and Aram. Because basically, he insulted what he came to do as being dumb. We already talked about the pride of man. And I want to pick up where we have Gehazi. So when Naaman is healed, verse 15 says, Naaman and all of his attendants went back to the man of God, that's Elisha. He stood before him and said, now I know that there is no God in all the world except Israel. That is a passage, that is a place in your Bible you should highlight that. That's a powerful, powerful statement. Listen to that. Now I know there is no God in all the world except in Israel. The God of Israelites, the God of Elisha, the God of these people is the God. There's only one, and it's Him. Isn't that powerful? So, please accept now a gift from your servant. The prophet Elisha answered, as surely as the Lord lives and I serve, I will not accept a thing. And even though Naaman urged him, he refused. If you will not, said Naaman, please let me, your servant, be given as much earth as a pair of mules can carry, for your servant will never again make burnt offerings and sacrifices to any other god but the Lord. But may the Lord forgive your servant for this one thing. When my master enters the temple of Ramon, and he bows down and is leaning on my arm, and I bow there also, when I bow down in the temple of Ramon, may the Lord forgive your servant for this. And Elisha said, go in peace. Now, this is an incredible time of conviction. Because he says, now, Elisha, I just want you to know one thing. I'm going to have to do something when I get back. I don't want to do it, but I don't have a choice. I'm asking you, please overlook it. Because when the king gets me back there, and he bows in the temple to Ramon, I'm going to have to stand right there, and he's going to lean on me, and I'm going to lower him to the ground, and I've got to go to the ground. And when that happens, please know what? I'm only doing it because physically I'm required to do it, but what about my heart? What about my mind? I'm not worshiping. If I do it, it is only because it's a requirement of my job to bow down, but it will not be in worship. And Elisha said, well, you're good. Go in peace. Go in peace. All right, so he turns to leave. After Naaman traveled some distance, Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, the man of God, said to himself, my master was too easy on Naaman, this Aramean, by not accepting from him what he brought. As surely as the Lord lives, I will run after him and get something from him. So Gehazi hurried after Naaman. When Naaman saw him running toward him, he got down from the chair to meet him. Is everything all right? He said. Everything is all right, Gehazi answered. My master sent to me to say, two young men from the company of the prophets have come to me from the hill country of Ephraim. Please give them a talent of silver and two sets of clothing. By all means, take two talents, said Naaman. He urged Gehazi to accept them. And then he tied up the two talents of silver and two bags with two sets of clothing. He gave to two of his servants, and they carried him ahead of Gehazi. When Gehazi came to the hill, he took the things from the servants and put them away in his house. And he sent the men away, and they left. And he went in and stood before his master Elisha. Where have you been, Gehazi? Elisha asked. Your servant didn't go anywhere, Gehazi answered. But Elisha said to him, was not my spirit with you when the man got down from his chariot to meet you? Is this the time to take money or accept clothes, olive groves, vineyards, flocks, herds, or manservants, maidservants? Naaman's leprosy will cling to you and your descendants forever. Then Gehazi went from Elisha's presence, and he was leprous, as white as snow.
A group of Hebrew scholars about 150 BC translated the Hebrew
have a new rendering in the English by Cambridge. And the Septuagint calls wherever it says false prophets or false teachers in our version, it calls them ventriloquists. And that really shows that the Jews knew they were special. They knew they had something nobody else had. Me.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And it's so interesting how Gehazi justified or rationalized his actions to the point that it was okay to go back and lie to Naaman, to deceive Naaman, and to get the goods from Naaman, to get it to his house, hide it, then go back to Elisha like nothing happened. Again, this is a great lesson to share with our children, grandchildren. People today totally disregard ethics and integrity. Today, kids will do whatever or what they can get by with. They will lie to your face. I may have told you this story before, but years ago when I was coaching and teaching, I was the chairman of the disciplinary committee at our school, and we had somebody that was stealing stuff from some lockers. We couldn't catch him. So we put some film on one of the janitor's closets so that you couldn't see. It was like, looked like a reflection on the outside, but you could see through it from the inside. And we put a camera there, and we just turned it on in the day, and we caught the person who was stealing. So I brought them into a meeting and basically said, you know, we've had a problem with stealing here, and I want you to know that we have good reason to suspect that you're the one responsible for getting into people's lockers and stealing wallets and money and things. And they immediately got defensive. They immediately got mad and said, that's a lie. I can't believe you're accusing me of that. And I said, well, we've got some good evidence to indicate that you, in fact, did do it. And I understand that people make mistakes. People, I don't know why you might have done this, but, you know, good people can do bad things sometimes. And we just need you to own it. We need you to be accountable for it. And they went into a rage. Start pointing their finger at me, yelling at me. And I'm going to tell you something. When a teenager starts that, whoo, it lights my world. And they told me their parents were so-and-so, which I already knew their parents were. And yes, I know they had a lot of money. Yes, they get a lot of money from school. And yes, this and that. And then I said, in a very calm voice, after they calmed down for me, a very calm, low voice, I said, just so you know, you got it on you. And they said, oh, okay, you got me. But just moments before, declaring before God their innocence, and how dare you accuse the innocent child that I am of such thievery? How could you? You wait till my father hears this. You'll be fired. Let me tell you something. We have to deal with these things with our kids. Our kids see what's going on in school. They see what other kids are doing. And they let it impact their thinking. They let it impact them to thinking, well, maybe so-and-so's not, maybe that's not so bad because nobody seems to care. Nobody's doing anything about it. Well, everybody knows what's going on. Nobody said a word. And when I can get them just to be quiet and just shut up for a minute and just listen to me, I say to them, your integrity matters. Who you are as a person when nobody's looking, that's what counts. And the person that God sees matters. Irregardless of what everybody else will do. Because I say to them, you're going to be surrounded by a lot of people your age that are not going to do the right thing. And the question comes down to, what does God expect out of you? What will your decision be? What will your behavior be like? Are you somebody that's honest as the day is long? And I'm telling you, it's scary, the lack of integrity teaching going on in our homes today in this country. Where there are adults teaching the kids to go and steal. There are adults putting up kids to go shoplifting in Walmart or Kroger. Why? Why'd they get the kids to do it? They're not going to get as much trouble. It'll get expunged from their record one day. And if they get away with it, then hey, we're good. If they don't, they'll slap them on the hand and tell them not to do it anymore. And we'll go on from there. We live in this huge sense of reality, and we've got to be better than that. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all of your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. This will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. In the end, having your head screwed on straight, as my dad used to say to me, having your head screwed on straight, having your heart right, having your mind right, and your actions full of integrity, is God going to bless that? Absolutely. The law of sowing and reaping comes into bear. Sometimes we talk about sowing and reaping that if you do bad things, you're going to reap it. But what if you sow the good? You're going to reap that as well. I believe that. Seek the Lord while He may be found. Call on Him while He is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the evil man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord, and He will have mercy on him, and to our God, for He will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Again, God has got to be the standard, not our intellect, not our education. God's word has to be our rule of life, our rule of law, Jason. Now, as I conclude our lesson today in thinking about this skewed sense of reality, realize that we live in times that are secular. This is not the worst time there's ever been on the earth. What is happening today has happened many times throughout the history of mankind. This is not the first time that societies have had issues of immoral integrity. Back in the days of the Israelites, God's people, not foreign country who worship false gods. God's people struggle with integrity. God's people struggle with obedience. Ezekiel chapter 22. Again, the word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, say to this land, you are a land that has had no rain or showers in the day of wrath. There is a conspiracy of her, that's princes, it didn't show up good in my copy. You may not be able to see that good. There's a conspiracy of her princes, governmental leaders, if you will. When under like a roaring lion tearing its prey, they devour people, take treasures and the precious things, and make many widows within her. Governmental leaders are doing what to their own people? Taking advantage of them for profit. Does that happen today? Are there people been put in places of authority that instead of doing what's right and honorable, they're taking advantage of it for their own personal gain? Her priests do violence to my law and profane my holy things. They do not distinguish between the holy and the common. They teach that there is no difference between the unclean and the clean. And they shut their eyes to the keeping of my Sabbaths so that I am profaned among them. The priests, who are the ones that should have been setting the record straight, that it should have been speaking truth, that should have been the one to turn to if you had a question about how to live your life, the priests, they were skewed in their thought. They couldn't tell the difference between what's holy and unholy, between what's clean and unclean. They even profaned the Sabbath day. They didn't keep them properly anymore. And if the priests were like that, then what about the people? Does it trickle down? Yeah. Her officials within her are like wolves tearing the prey. They shed blood and kill people to make unjust gain. Her prophets whitewash these deeds for them by false visions and lying divinations. They say, listen to this. This is what the Lord says, the sovereign Lord says, when the Lord has not spoken. Making up stuff in the name of religion so people will do what they want them to do. Or people will be happy doing whatever they want to do. Tell them what they want to hear. The people of the land practice extortion, commit robbery, oppress the poor and the needy, and mistreat the alien, denying them justice. I look for a man among them who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of this land, so that I would not have to destroy it. But I found none. So I will pour out my wrath on them and consume them with my fiery anger, bring down on their own heads all that they have done, declares the sovereign Lord. So you have the Israelites, people that knew better, should have known better, should have done better. They didn't have the excuse that there was idolatry in the land, and the people didn't even know God. They didn't even know the will of God or the word of God. There were no excuses for all of that. These are God's people. And they turned from truth. They turned from God and decided to do whatever they felt like doing. And God says, you've been warned and warned and warned. And so you are facing my judgment. Verse 30 says, I looked from among them for a man that would stand in the gap and take up the hedge from the Lord, and I found none. I've said this before, and I think it's so important. God is still on his throne today. God's will be done. You stand with God and you stand for right. God's going to bless you. I believe that we are preordained by God to be here at this time, at this moment, in this place, to make a powerful force for good and righteousness in our society. I don't think that we need to cower and be scared and full of fear. I don't think we should be intimidated. I don't think that we should be ashamed of our faith. I think we need to stand for God and with God and speak truth, live truth, and let God bless us to do what's right, regardless of what anybody else says or does. That is the hope of this country, ladies and gentlemen. If Christians fail God, then this country has no hope. It will be destroyed. Not from a foreign country. I don't think we'll ever have to worry about a foreign power taking us over by force. We'll rot from the inside out, and we'll fall to pieces, just like the Roman Empire. Nobody destroyed the Roman Empire by a force from outside. It destroyed itself. And I thank God that in this country today, there are still millions of Christians who believe that God's word is valid, the truth, and the way to live.
Amen.
We just got to quit being so silent about it and not be intimidated by the forces of darkness. And stand for truth, live truth, speak truth, and let truth be the judge. Let's pray. Our Father, we pray that our reality will come straight from you. The reality of how you view us and how we should view ourselves. Of what is truth and what is the standard of righteousness, irregardless of what society taints or changes. May we stand by your word and let it guide our hearts, our minds, and our lives. All the decisions that we make. And Father, we declare to you today that we're not self-righteous. We are not egotistical. We don't think that we're always right and everybody else is wrong. We fail you too. But help us to be accountable to you when we do fail you, to repent of the things in our life that are amiss, and constantly make changes that would point our children and ourselves and our community back to you at all times. Give us that kind of faith and result. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Thank you all so much.